greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and certainly it's good to be in the house of the Lord, even if that's in your living room, in your dining room, wherever that might be. Greetings to you and blessings in the name of our Lord. Now to our Facebook and our YouTube participants, we ask that you would comment as you feel free, and certainly if you know what we're talking about, just let some hearts fly and show some love and show some thumbs up. But it's so good to be here one more time to talk to you, to break the bread of life by way of Bible study. So at this time, I'm going to ask Reverend Dr. Linda Bullock to read the scripture for us. And following that, we'll have a prayer by Deacon Irvin Bullock at this time.
Okay, I'm reading St. John 15 chapter. This, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word, which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me ye can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch, and is withered. And men gather them, and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I read St. John the 15th chapter, verses 1 through 10. And this is the word of the Lord, and it is already blessed.
Amen.
Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come thanking you, O God, today for your loving kindness. Thanking you for your tender mercy, O God, that you show toward us over and over again. Lord, we lift up your name and we come thanking you, Lord, for another opportunity where we can come together in spirit, O God, to fellowship, to learn of you, to learn of what your word says. O God, we lift up the pastor as he comes and speak unto us your word. O God, and may we accept your word of our hearts, that we may not sin against you. O God, we thank you for everyone that's on the line, everyone that hear my voice. O God, I pray and thanking you at the same time that they will be blessed tonight by your word. We thank you and give you all the glory. We give you all the praise. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We certainly want to thank Reverend Bullock, and we want to thank Deacon Bullock for the fervent prayer and for the reading of God's holy word. And we say to all of you again, we greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and it's certainly good to be in your presence again tonight to come to you by way of Bible study. Now at this time, I want to try to just play a little bit of a song that we did at in-house. Let me find it and listen to the song just a little bit, and then we'll come back and go from there. All right, this song is By and By, sung by vine. She was singing with our youth choir. Amen. Bye and bye. All right. Okay, so we thank God for the song. We know that by and by everything's going to be all right if we just hold on and hold out. Let me say a few words of introduction here again, or just a few preliminary words I'd like to share with you on today. First of all, we ask that all who have not already done so, if you would like to stop by the church as you drop your tithes and your offerings off at the church, those that do come by each week and drop off your tithes and your offerings, we ask that you pick up your communion set. We'll have that ready for you when you come by to drop off your tithes and your offerings. And of course, if you cannot make it out by Sunday, of course, you know we are having our communion service this Sunday as well as Mother's Day. And so if you can't come by, simply use some bread or crackers or some juice or water or something that you already have in your homes. Certainly, we will say a prayer of consecration and bless it, so that we all can be on one accord as we partake in the Lord's Supper. So come on by and pick up your communion, your communion set, the cup of grape juice and the wafer set. Come by and pick that up this Saturday. Amen. And to all of you, I want to thank you again before we get into our Bible study. I want to thank you all for being diligent and being persistent with the paying of your tithes and your offerings. And I don't like to use the word paying. I guess the better word is gifting, giving of your tithes and your offerings. As you know that the Lord said if you bring forth of the tithe and the offerings, he would open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. There shall not be room enough to receive. So we thank you for being persistent and being consistent with coming by and dropping off of your tithe and your offerings. And for all of our guests out there that view via YouTube, Facebook, and you may just have in your heart that you want to contribute or donate a monetary sum to us, to the ministry, you feel free to do so. You can log on to our website, www.cleversoak.org. It's also on the slide, the screen show right in front of you, but it's www.cleversoak.org, and there's an online button at the top of the web page that you feel free to donate if you so choose to. I know some people realize the power and the blessings in giving, and so if you want to do that, or you can simply mail your contribution, your donation to Clevers Oak Baptist Church, 13852 Silliman, Sillamon, Silliman Road, Gold Vein, Virginia, 22720. You can mail it if you want to contribute to the ministry. As we know, it takes finances and revenue for the ministry to flourish and to continue. Amen. I don't want to harbor on that too much, lest you say I'm asking too much for your money. But we know that you're so grateful and you're so gracious to where you do that without me having to beg. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Nobody mad but the devil. Nobody mad. We're glad to have all of you on our conference line, and all of you who have come via the YouTube Live and the Facebook Live. And we're just so thankful and grateful. Now, I'm not going to hold you too long tonight. That has never have been my intention for any service, as I don't believe it takes all day and all night to do the work of the Lord. You just do what the Spirit lead and tell you to do, and then you say goodbye. But tonight our lesson, as you see on the screen that's facing you there, the lesson for the night will be along the lines of eternal security. Eternal security. Once saved, always saved. Once saved, always saved. So before I get into the lesson, I'm going to say real quick another prayer. God, we thank you and bless you. We give your name glory and honor because you're worthy, O God. You're worthy to be praised. Thank you for another opportunity to be about your business, O God, and to come and to open up and to break your bread of life. Lord, we ask that you would forgive us of all sins. You would consecrate and anoint afresh even now. Sanctify this thing, O God, that you be glorified, but that your church be edified. Lord, open up the scriptures and illuminate, O God, illuminate our minds now, O God. Edify us, Lord, that as we need your word in these last and evil days. So have thine own way, God, as we come now to break the bread of life. It is in your Son Jesus' name that we sign this prayer, O God, in Jesus' name, amen. All righty. So then, I'm going to start here tonight. It's really a lot of scripture. So if you want your Bible, but most of the scriptures I do have already will have laid out for you, but if you want your Bibles to keep along with tracking along with us, do so. But as a theme scripture, so to say, I want to use John 10, verses 27 through 30. That's kind of the theme scriptures for this lesson on tonight. Again, that's John 10, verses 27 through 30. And let me go ahead and read those verses. It says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." Verse 28 says, "And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one." Amen. Thus ends the reading of the word. It is already blessed. That's John chapter number 10, verses 27 through verse 30. All right, tonight we want to talk about eternal security. Eternal security, which simply is a situation where we often say and we believe that once saved, always saved. The Bible teaches that once you are saved, you cannot lose your salvation. There's a phrase amongst the church community, the Christian community and the church, that goes, once saved, always saved. It's the principle known as eternal security. Eternal security. Now there are mainly two schools of thought as it pertains to eternal security. You're either pro or con. You're either for it or you're against it, eternal security. I myself believe, according to scriptures, that once you are saved, you're always saved and can never lose your salvation. I'm a firm believer, and that's the position and that's the stance that I take, that once saved. I don't believe that we have a God that we serve who's not able to keep you once he bring you in. I just simply cannot fathom the thought that God is not able to keep you and to hold you. Amen. And so let's look a little further at what we're talking about. Now, not everyone and not everybody support eternal security. There are those that have differing views. Now, according to Hebrews, here's one of the misleading scriptures, and you'll see it on the screen there. It's Hebrews 6. Hebrews chapter 6, verses 4 through 6. It can be misleading, as it appears to contradict eternal security. It appears that way. This verse implies that people who have strayed or fallen from their faith cannot be saved again, thus voiding out the principle of eternal security. Now let me see. Look at, if you had your Bibles, you could look at Ephesians 4 and 30. Ephesians 4 and 30 says, "And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption." See, once you accept Christ and you're sealed unto the day of redemption. I mean, the Spirit seals us. There's no losing. We'll get into it a little deeper, but there's no losing of your salvation. Once you're saved, there's no losing of your salvation. Also, in the great commentary, Charles H. Spurgeon, he wrote a book called When Christ Returns. He assigns the following interpretation to the scripture, to Matthew 6, 25 through 28 is another one that sometimes throws us off as it pertains to eternal security. And it suggests, it says, this verse may well have been aimed directly at those followers who would defect from the faith, grasp at the world, endeavor to save their lives, but really they lose their lives and barter their souls, suggesting that a defection from the faith could compromise eternal security. I just wanted to bring those two pieces up front in the lesson, so that you can also see that there are folk out there who have a differing of opinions as it pertains to eternal security. But my argument tonight in our Bible lesson is to support the fact, according to Scripture, that once saved, always saved. Let me go ahead and read this verse, these verses. For Matthew 16, 25 through 28 says, "For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man, profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange as a barter for his soul? For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father and his angels, and then he shall reward every man according to his works." He says, and then the word says, "Verily I say unto you, there shall be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." But Spurgeon lends commentary to Matthew 16, 25 through 28, which suggests that defecting from the faith or falling from the faith could compromise eternal security. But the devil is a lie. I just simply cannot buy into that theory, because I believe the God that we serve is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless, according to Jude, the book of Jude, to present you faultless to the Father in the end day. Amen. So let's move on to the next slide here. Now, the age-old question, and the question that's on the table today, is really, can someone truly saved lose his or her faith for a period of time, a period of years, and then become saved again? Can you get back on right terms with God, or do you just have to hope that God will have mercy on you and take you back into his family? Look at what Jeremiah says about it. And see, that's what I like to do. I like to take these questions and these arguments and have the scripture talk to them. Jeremiah 3 and 14 said, he said, "Turn, O backsliding children, saith the Lord, for I am married." That's what Jeremiah said about it. He said, "I am married unto you, and I will take you, one of a city and two of a family, and will bring you to Zion," Zion being the promised land, for us being the heavenly place, glory land. So then we see the word, backsliding, backslider. Now, in the principle of eternal security, there is the premise of being a backslider. You can slide back. The word backslide means to revert to a worse condition, or to lapse, or to fall morally, or in the practice of one's religion. The Hebrew word for backsliding, as used in Jeremiah's verses, is pronounced sobab. And it means abandoning a religious or political belief or principle. So a Christian can indeed backslide. A child of God can backslide, but Jeremiah makes it very, very plain that if you are saved, you can backslide, but that God is married to you. You don't lose your salvation, but there is, let's go one step deeper. So then in reading this, it says, so then there is a possibility of a Christian backsliding, falling, if you will. However, God is eternally married to the backslider, and it does not remove you from your place of salvation. What it does is it moves you further away from God when God is trying to get us to draw nigh to him. So the backslider does not lose. It moves you further away from God, but not to the place of being unsaved. Once you're saved, brothers and sisters, that's it. You're saved. Hallelujah, and bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. If you're saved. Now look, this applies, and I have this in all caps, and the word "truly saved" in red letters. This applies only if you are truly, hear me, truly saved in the first place. Now you can't, this doesn't apply to you if you're not saved. You have got to be truly saved for this to apply. As far as what we're talking about backsliding, if you're truly saved, it said this applies to you if you're truly saved in the first place. Emphasis on the words "truly saved." Amen. Amen. Now, you know, the reason I'm bringing up this lesson tonight is because I believe there are a lot who are coming back to the church, and in the minds of many of God's people, they believe that I have done so much wrong that the Lord doesn't want me anymore. I'm not worthy to even be in His presence. But God is calling the church back. He's calling us back to the church and back to the place of righteousness. So don't ever turn your back thinking that you lost your salvation. No, no, no. What if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God hath raised Him from the dead? The Bible says, my four favorite words, thou shalt be saved. That's what the Bible says. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. That's Romans 10 and 9. Good God from Mount Zion and verse 10. But if you're truly saved, you always have salvation. It's eternal to you. It's eternal. And as we go further, I believe you'll see this picture a little bit better. Let's look at a few more points to support the principle of eternal security. Tonight we want to discuss, and as you know, I try to be a little structured about my study sessions, but we want to talk about at least four points, and I want to give them to you right up front. And we'll go down through the lesson until we complete all four of them. But the first point I want to elaborate on is Jesus' death secured our salvation. His death, that's number one. Our salvation is secured. Jesus' death secured it. Number two, the saved are given to Jesus, given to Him as a permanent possession. We're a permanent possession when we come to Jesus, and when Jesus, when we accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we're a permanent possession. And then number three is eternal life begins at conversion, and it never ends. There's no end to your salvation, and that's why we beckon you to come to Jesus and give your life to the Lord, because There is once saved. I see you, Sister Ralph. Once saved. I see you there, Sister Flo. Once saved, always saved. Amen. Amen. And the fourth point. God's will is the preserving of the saints. That's His will. He wants to keep us and present us faultless. He wants to preserving of the saints. So let's go down through these points. And this is the Bible study on tonight, eternal security. Eternal security. All right. So, the first of the points is that Christ's death secured salvation for all mankind. Now, we know that Christ was crucified. He hung on the cross. And the reason He did all of that is to secure us a place in glory, that He might redeem us and buy us back. According to Hebrews 9:11-15, let's see what that. 11 through is quite a bit to read, but I'm gonna read a little bit of it. We in Bible study, we're not in a super hurry, but let me read this. It says, "But Christ being high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not." Of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by His own blood, He entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered Himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. And for this cause He is the mediator of the New Testament, and by means of His death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament, they which are called might receive the promise," listen to this, "the promise of eternal inheritance." And so by His own blood, He entered in once into the holy place. He obtained eternal redemption for us. So Christ's mission was to die so that we could live. But then once we become saved, His death becomes our eternal salvation. It becomes our opportunity for eternal salvation. I have two points here on my layout that says by His own blood He obtained eternal redemption for us, and that by His death for the redemption of mankind, that they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. So his death secured our salvation, and salvation is secured through and by the death of Jesus Christ on the cross. He shed his blood for you and me, and that, and according to the Hebrews, he for once and for all, he was a lad. We don't have to do the bullocks and the goat and the lamb. We don't have to sacrifice animals anymore. Christ was the last sacrifice, the Lamb of God on the cross, to secure our salvation. You don't have to worry. If you were saved, if you confess and profess Christ and confessed him and believe in your heart at one point in your life, and I can give you a little bit of my testimony. At the age of 12, I received salvation. But as I got a little older, I defected from the faith by my voluntary will. I defected from the faith, but in my upcoming, my dad and my mother, they kept us in the church. I knew the scripture well. I knew I had a close relationship with the Lord. But for some reason, I had this mental blockage that I want to just run rampant in the street. But I don't ever encourage nobody to do that, because the Lord showed me grace and he showed me mercy and allowed me to come back. And so, I don't want to encourage nobody to try that, because you might not be quite as fortunate. But anyway, on the principle of eternal security, God has a way to keep you. The Bible said that once you're in his hand, nobody can pluck you out. So don't you worry about just if you have been saved at one point and you've been out there and you feel like you're not worthy and you're too far away from God, the devil is a lie. Come on back. God is calling you back to the church. God is trying to get you back to the church. Let's move on to the next slide here. The second point, which is eternal security. The saved or the elect of God are given to Christ as a permanent possession. Not temporary, not a temporal fix, but as a permanent possession. And my point here says, all that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. I will in no wise cast out. The Father draw us to the Son, the Son receives us, and he holds us in the palm of his hand. And you know what? Jesus' hand is so awesome that he can hold all of us at the same time. That's how powerful, that's how awesome, that's how big, that's how large, that's how phenomenal God is. That's how he leaves us in awestruck, because he can handle all of our situations, all of our souls at once in the palm of his hand. And nobody can, once we get in there, now I got to throw this in here, because I was teaching this one time and somebody had mentioned to me that they had heard somebody mention to them that, well, you can jump out of God's hand. Nobody can pluck you out, but you can jump out. Well, I simply say that once you taste, the psalmist say, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Once you taste and see that God is good, I promise you, if you get a good taste of the Lord, you ain't going to be jumping out of his hand. I hope I got a witness on that. Because God is good. Once you realize how good God is, you ain't jumping. You are not going to jump out of God's hand. God got you. Look, it says here, the second point here, it says this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth here in the Greek, meaning acknowledge or view mentally or to perceive, that everyone which perceive or view mentally the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. God, Jesus is assuring us that once you come into him, he's going to hold you until the very end, to the last day. He's going to raise you up. He's going to raise, just like he got up, you're going to get up. Amen. And if you happen to be here during the time of the rapture, you'll be transformed. You'll take on a new a new body, and the Bible tells us dead in Christ shall rise first, we which are alive and remain shall be caught up to meet him in the air. But don't worry about the fact that I feel like I lost my salvation. You know, when I was growing up, now I might as well go ahead and tell this. I know some people down south probably looking, but I got to tell it anyway. I remember at some of these old revivals we would go to, sometimes you see people go up to the altar every night, and the comment would be, I want to be saved. Now, you were saved one time already, and so why are you coming back on Tuesday night to be saved? And then you come back again on Wednesday night. What happened to your salvation between Sunday and Monday? But every other night you at the altar saying you want to be saved again. And so something's wrong with that picture. See, once you're saved, it don't take but one time. It don't take but one time. God is a powerful God. He'll save your soul. And you don't have to worry about trying to be resaved, because once he saved you, it's settled. As he got you. He said he got you. He got you. He got you. He got you. Let me move on to, let me see what verse, I'm going to read John 10, 25 through 29 real quick. Let me read that. It says, Jesus answered them, I told you, and ye believe not. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. But ye believe not, because ye are not of my sheep. As I said unto you, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life. And they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. See, when you're in Christ, can no man, can no devil in hell steal your salvation. They might lock you in a prison or in a jail cell. They might try to rough you up and treat you wrong. They might try to do they might even try to put you to the place of death. But they cannot mess with your salvation, because salvation is a gift from God. It's eternal life. And I promise you, it will be with you until, remember what we said in the first few slides, this only applies if you're truly saved. The question you ought to be asking yourself is, am I saved? You know, you ought to, you know, again, the blueprint for salvation is Romans 10 and 9. And it says, but if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, the Bible says thou shalt be saved. Now, there's also another supporting scripture, Ephesians 1, and I believe it's somewhere in the lesson, we'll come across it again, but Ephesians 1 and like 13 said that at the point of belief, you are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. And he's going to keep you until the day of redemption. And so we're given to Christ as a permanent possession. There's no temporal or temporary thing about salvation. You're saved, and you're saved forever. You're saved for good. Amen. And that's why, I got to reemphasize that I wouldn't serve this God if I didn't think he was able to keep me or to hold me from the wiles of the devil, or even from myself, because the flesh in us, in your body, in the flesh dwelleth no good thing. And so we sometimes veer off from the right road because of the lust in our flesh. And so don't worry about it. If you're saved, then you're always saved. If you're not saved, then tonight's call to you to become saved. To talk to the Lord, to fall down on your knees and talk to him in the inner place of your spirit, and let him know that you want salvation, and you want him in your life, and you want him to be Lord over your life. And just ask him to come into your heart, and you're tired of living, and now you got to mean it. If you mean it, and God knows your heart. But once you're saved, always saved. Don't you worry. Don't you worry about a thing. About this, you know, there's people out there who has all kinds of theories and all kinds of contrary thoughts as it applies to this subject. But you have to believe in what the radio, we have a guy up here in Virginia called Willie Moe Jr. He said, you got to believe in your sha-na-na. Yeah, deep down in the crevice of your heart that God got you, and you stand on it. Amen. And you stand on it. Amen. Amen. Because, you know, it's all about faith. We walk by faith and not by sight. And so just know that when you're saved, and you're the elect of God, you're given to Christ as a permanent possession. You're His for all eternity from that point on. Amen. Let me move on to point number 3. Let me read this. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them. We talked about that. No man can pluck us out of God's hand. That's how powerful and that's how strong God is. He's a powerful God. Amen. I thank y'all for coming on. I see you. Come on in. I see you still dialing. Some still coming in on the call line. But come on in. Come on in. We're talking about eternal security. And if you know what I'm talking about, let them show some love and let them hearts fly and throw some of them thumbs up. But we're talking about eternal security. And Lord, we need eternal security in these last and evil days. We need to know that. We know, according to, remember old James Cleveland sung that song, gotta know that you know that you know, deep down on the crevices and the cracks and the hollow, the deep places of your heart. You got to know that you know that you know that you're saved. And once you're saved, don't let nobody fool you, you know, because sometimes we in the very first part of the lesson, we talked about the backsliding situation. Now, all of us drift every now and then. Let me just expound on that just a little bit. I'm going to pull up my next screen. But all of us drift. Sometimes we drift. But it's at that time when you recognize that you're drifting, you ought to fall on your knees and call on the name of the Lord and ask Him to help you. Call on the Holy Spirit. He's there to help you. He's waiting for you to call on Him to help you in these situations. Because if we drift too far, you know, and I always, Deacon Charles Webster know what I'm about to say, but when you drift on the Lord, see what the problem many of us have is sometimes we get a little distant from God. We stop praying, we stop reading the Word, we get too busy to where we stop coming to church, we don't even come do the Bible study thing, we don't read the Word or nothing, and we start drifting on the Lord. And the more you drift, the further away you move from God. And see, there was a time when you were so close to God, you could just talk to Him in a normal tone. But the further you drift away, the louder you have to talk to God, because God is not being able to hear you as clear because you're drifting too far. Some of us are drifting so far, we got to holler at the top of our lungs, because we're drifting. But when you find yourself drifting or moving away from the Lord, repent of your sins. Fall down on your knees. Talk to Him and let Him know that you need help getting back into the right place in Him. You ain't too big. You ought not be too big to humble yourself to the place to where you want to let the Lord know you need help. Amen. Point number 3, eternal life begins at conversion, and by definition will never end. Oh, this is where that scripture I was talking about earlier, Ephesians. Of course, you see, now, let me say this before I talk about this. All of this scripture that's on this, on the presentation and in this video will always be back up in the archive, the library archive on Facebook and YouTube. Now, I'm moving a little fast. You're not able to write all this down. And I wanted to share with you that you don't really need to write it down right now unless you just want to. It'll be in archive. You can go back up and hit replay, and you can pause it wherever you want to and check out these scriptures. Amen. But I have each one of these scriptures. We know John 3:16. God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son. John 3:36. He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. And he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. And all of these scriptures are in here. When we're done with this lesson, If you have a desire to come back out to Facebook or to our YouTube channel, you can always replay the archive. But eternal life begins at conversion. When you accept the Lord and you're tired of living a wayward life, and you accept the Lord and you want to come back, and you're at that place now where you're saying, Lord, fix me up because I need your help. I need salvation. I want salvation. Will you come into my life and save me? Turn me around. So you repent. Repent is a 180-degree turn. You repent of your sins, fall on your knees, and you ask the Lord to come in to your life. The Lord at that point will, now, you know, nothing going to change with your feet. Nothing going to change with your hands. You're going to look the same way. It's just that your spirit will be enlightened. And so at the point of belief, this is a very important scripture as it pertains to the rudiments of salvation. Let me pull it up here. It says, Ephesians 1 and 13, it says, in whom ye also trusted after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel, the good news of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed. See, you got to believe. After ye believe, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. And you know what a seal means. Seal means sealing something tight. You remember Mama and them used to have those vegetables that they would put in these jars, and they would put the seal tight top on it, and they keep them things for years because that seal, and they're good as long as that seal is not broken. Well, Jesus seals us. The Holy Spirit seals us at the point of belief. He seals us until the day of redemption. And so at the point of belief, the deal is sealed by the Holy Spirit. And all we've got to do is trust and believe and have faith that God is able to save us, to pick us up and to turn us around. And don't ever forget Romans 10 and 9. It says, at the point of conversion, thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God believe. You see that word believe? In thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead. Thou shalt be saved. Now listen, brothers and sisters, we need to be saved. You hear what I'm saying? It's time out for playing church or trying to do church and going through the motions. It's time out for that. It's time in for us to be saved. God is coming back soon. Listen, you're living in the last and evil days. We're living in the last days, what they call perilous times. Timothy, Paul wrote in the book of Timothy about perilous times. We're living in the last days. And it's time that we become saved and sanctified. And quit playing church. Amen. If the shoe fit, go ahead and wear it. You know the condition of your soul. Quit playing church and get real about this thing, because one of these days, according to the scriptures, he's going to come back again. We call it that's the very next thing on, according to theology, that's the very next thing on God's kingdom agenda, is the rapture of his church. And the Bible says before these things happen, there's going to be all kinds of stuff that's going to go on in the earth. And as we look at the news, we see that those things are transpiring. Somebody ought to say amen. All these wars and rumors of wars and all these chaotic situations and killings and murderings and all this homosexuality and lesbianism and all of these waywardness and oh Lord, you just name it. When you look at the news and you look at your television set, you'll see how this world, we are in the last and evil days. Corrupt men, vile men who are lovers of their own selves. And Lord have mercy, we're in the last days, so you need to get your life right with Jesus. Fix it up with the Lord. Amen. Amen. It begins at conversion, and by definition, it will never, ever end. He said he loved the world so until he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting and eternal life. That's never ending. It's never ending, never ending. Salvation, if you look at my little graphic illustration, the road represents your salvation, and up in the clouds, they're never ending, never ending. There's no end. It's permanent. It's not temporary. Let me see if I can pull up one or two of these scriptures to help support the point a little bit. Let me look at John 17:1-3. These words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, thou hast come glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee, as thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life. Eternal. See that word eternal? Eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, Christ whom thou hast sent. Eternal life. This thing is eternal. But the problem we have, brothers and sisters, before I move on to the fourth point, the problem we really have is folk are deceived and thinking they are saved. They, you know, and there's a difference. Just coming to church is not, that's not the definition of being saved. Doing the church thing, that's not, no. Some say, well, God know my heart and I do good deeds. Good deed, there are some good deed people who are going to end up in hell. You have got to do it according to the scriptures. You have got to confess with that mouth of yours, the Lord Jesus, and believe with that heart of yours. Believe in your heart that God raised his Son from the dead. You have to believe that. In the book of Acts, they who call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You put the heart, the mind, and the mouth and unify that in prayer and ask God to come in and save you. You will be, that would be the definition of salvation, and it is not temporal, it is eternal. It's eternal security. It's once saved, and it don't take but one time. You know, to all those who go back to the altar every year at the annual revival and want to be saved again, it's not necessary. Chances are you hadn't had your first salvation if you're going back to be saved again. Amen. So now there's a chance you may have backslidden, as we talked earlier in the lesson, but if you are truly saved, then always saved. You're saved. You're good to go. Amen. Let me go to the next point in the next slide. My final point in the last slide here of the lesson, it's God is sovereign in salvation. His will must be accomplished, and he wills the preserving of the saints. His will is to keep us from falling, to preserve us. Look, John 6:39, it says, and this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all those he has given me, but raise them up at the last day. So you ought to rejoice and be glad that the Lord, the Father, have given you to Jesus. Jesus have saved your soul, and if he saved your soul, he's going to preserve you until the bitter end, until the very end. There's not going to be no bitter end. It's the very end. Amen. So God is sovereign in salvation. His will must be accomplished. Let me read Job 42:2, what it says. It says, I know that you can do all things and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Yeah, the devil might try. You remember what the scripture said? No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Yeah, he might try. The weapon might form up, but it's not going to prosper, because nothing, no purpose under the sun, no purpose can be thwarted. God's plan will be carried out. His will shall be done. Remember Jesus said, nevertheless, not my will, thine will be done. His will shall be done, and there's no purpose under the sun, nothing nobody can do or say that can thwart God's plan for your life. And so, look at Isaiah 14:24. It says, the Lord of hosts hath sworn, saying, surely as I live, surely as I have thought, so shall it come to pass, and as I have purposed, so shall it stand. So when God's involved with it, brothers and sisters, you can't mess with it. Can't no devil in hell can thwart God's purpose, and once he wants us saved, And then he wants us to know that he's able to keep us from falling. Let me see if I can find that scripture. I keep talking about it, but it's in the book of Jude. I should have wrote that one on my slide, but that keep coming to my mind. So let me turn in my Bible here and find it. It says down here, matter of fact, it's listed as the doxology of the church. It's now unto him that is able to keep you. Jude is only one chapter, so verse 24. Jude 1 and 24. It's not on my layout, but it says, now unto him that is able to keep. Remember the old church used to say the Holy Ghost was the keeping power? God got the power to keep us. It says, now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. Amen. God is able to keep us. He preserves us. He walks with us in the valley places. He goes with us up on the happy days and in the mountaintop scenes. He's already around the curves and the turns and the bends before we get there. God preserves us. Yeah, every now and then he'll allow some trials and some tests to come your way just to see if you know where you are in your faith, if you love him or if you're just shucking and jiving, you know. God, he's in the preserving. He's sovereign in his salvation. His will be accomplished in that when he seek out to save you, he's going to save you and he's going to preserve you until the day of redemption, until the last day. Let me look at Isaiah 14 and 24. Did we already talk about that one? Yes, we did. Matthew 18, 12 through 14 said, how think ye, if a man have 100 sheep and one of them be gone astray, does he not leave the 99 and go into the mountains and seek of that which is gone astray? And if so be that he find it, verily I say unto you, he rejoices more of that one sheep than of the 99 which went not astray. Even so it is, not the will of your Father which is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. None of us. God don't want none of us. You know, remember that old logo jargon that they say, leave none behind? That's what God is saying to his people and to the church. He don't want to leave not one behind. When the rapture comes, he wants to secure your soul and he wants to bring you on into glory. But that's really what we're talking about tonight, eternal security. We're coming here to a landing now, just about to close it out here. It concludes that we covered the following points tonight. Jesus' death secured salvation for us. We talked about number two, the saved are given to Jesus as a permanent possession. We talked about eternal life begins at conversion, but it never ends. And then we talked about God's will is the preserving of the saints. It is his will to keep you and to hold you out until the bitter to the very end. Amen. And so I'm a strong believer, and I just support the fact that God grants eternal security. Once saved, always saved. Once saved, always saved. And so, brothers and sisters, that end this lesson, this spiel I have for tonight. Now, there's much more to eternal security. I can't tell it all in one night, but this, I thank you all for hearing me out. And again, if you want to come back and look over these scriptures and this lesson, it will still be out there posted in the archive. You can go to our website and just click the Facebook Live or the YouTube Live, and you might have to, every computer is kind of configured a little bit different. You might have to do a thing or two to get to it, but it should take you where you need to be, and you can look at the archive for this lesson on tonight. I thank you so much for listening in. Let me just say a few things by way of reminder here. And also, if you have any special prayer requests, if you type them in the comment lines or get that word to us some kind of way, we will certainly lift you all up in prayer. Thank you, everyone. I want to remind you. Thank you again. I don't want to take that for granted that you took of your time to participate in our Bible study. To all our guests, we thank you for coming. You didn't have to come tonight, but we thank you. And I see all your comments and all your hearts and your thumbs up that flew. And I'm able now to see all of you who are commenting and by way of YouTube and Facebook. But I want to say just a few more reminders here just before we close it out here. Saturday, when you come to drop off your tithes and your offering, to make sure if you have not done so already that you pick up your communion sets, your communion, your cup of juice and your wafer, your cracker set. And if you, again, if you don't want to or if you're not able to come by the church and pick up your set, just use what you have at home. We'll consecrate it through prayer. But we want to pass it out to you so that you have it ready so that when we come to service on Sunday, we're going to have communion as a church family. Amen. On one accord. And I'm so grateful again. I'm so grateful that you all are not slacking up on tithes and offerings. You all are doing awesome and doing, as a matter of fact, I believe we're doing a little better in this season than we did when we was going to church. But continue doing the work of the Lord. Continue giving back to the Lord. Amen. If anybody, let me just say this and then I'll get ready to close out. If anybody have need of transportation or have need of to get to your doctor's appointments or your meds or groceries or any of the essentials and you need assistance, senior, and you can't get around, please let us know. Let us know if you have need of anything. Get a word to us. If we can help you, we will. We'll do everything we can to help you. But we need to know. And if there's anybody sick, get that word to us. Text. All of you all have my number, and you can either text my phone or just get a word. Call me or call one of the deacons. Amen. Call one of the officers. And we want to see if we can help wherever we can. I just thank God for all of you who have come on, and we're going to continue. I thank you for your prayers for my uncle. We know death is a part of living, and we all are not going to remain on this earth forever. And so just pray, continue to pray for the Cubitt family and the Smiling family as we mourn and grieve over the loss of our uncle. And to all of those who have lost loved ones, we want to pray and let us know if there are any deaths or any deceased among us, that we might lift them up in prayer. And for the Bible says, the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Thank you so much, church, for hanging in there with me. And I apologize right now. I apologize for last week. We had an internet issue, an internet problem. Now, I'm going to tell you something. This technology is not to be played with. It is a lot to deal with, and we're doing the best we can. Keep on praying. I feel your prayers in my fingers and in my mind trying to put all this stuff together. So keep praying for me that we can continue to fellowship, that we can continue to have church. We don't have to be in that building because, remember, we are the church. But I want to thank you for your prayers. So at this time, I'm going to say a word of prayer, and then we're going to say goodnight to you. God, we thank you, and we bless you for what eyes have seen, what hearts have felt. We thank you for the word, oh God, of inspiration on tonight. Thank you for the Bible study, the Bible lesson. We all need to know in these days, oh God, that your salvation is eternal and it's secured, oh God. And once saved, oh God, always saved. We're just thankful that you have saved us and that you've picked us up when we were down and placed our feet on holy ground. We bless you for what you've done in our lives, times past, present, and future. We give you all glory, all praise, and all honor. We pray, oh God, even for those that are in government, Father, our president and his cabinet. Oh God, be his counsel, Father. Go with those up on Capitol Hill, our legislative branches, oh God. Go with the Congress, go with the Senate, go with the Supreme Justices, oh God. Just have mercy even upon the policemen and firemen and those medical people that's on the front lines, oh God. We pray, oh God, that you would protect them, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we ask that you would put an umbrella of protection around the church, oh God, the members of Clevers Oak Baptist Church, as well as all those out there, all your people, God, and keep us safe, oh God, from this COVID-19 coronavirus, oh God. We know that you have all power in the palm of your hand. You can destroy, you can defend. We know that you're able to do all things, those things exceeding abundantly above all that we might ask or think, according to your power that worketh in us. We give your name glory, Father. We know that, oh, according to your scripture, no weapon shall formed against thee shall prosper. We know, God, that you've got us, Lord, and we just give your name praise. Father, continue to look after your people, O God. Oh Lord, we ask your blessings upon the bereaved family and those that are mourning the loss of loved ones. Build up that which is torn, strengthen that which is weak, O God. Oh Father, just let your anointing flow free, God. Save that which is lost. Somebody today is not saved. We ask that you would save that lost soul in Jesus' name. Let virtue go from my lips, O God, into somebody's home, into somebody's heart, into somebody's ear, somebody's mind, into somebody's soul. And that, Lord God, you would do the regeneration and the converting of the soul, O God, that you would lift up that which is down and strengthen that which is weak, Lord. O God, just have thine own way, Lord. O God, write this word that we have taught and that we've talked about and discussed. Write it on the tables of our heart and press it in our minds that we might be doers and not just hearers of your word. Continue to bless church, and may your grace, love, fellowship, and sweet communion of your Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with this church, with all of us, under the sound of my voice, now, henceforth, and forevermore. And the redeemed of God said, amen, amen, and amen. God bless you, church, and may heaven smile. May it smile richly upon you until we shall meet again. Just remember the words I always say. God loves, he really does. He loves you. Amen. God bless you and good night.